In the last video, we explored the flapping degree of freedom of a helicopter rotor blade and why it's essential for aircraft control. In today's video, we'll take a look at lead lag motion to understand why this particular degree of freedom is needed. If you're not committed to a full-length video, a really short answer is that lead lag motion allows for the conservation of angular momentum when the blades flap about an offset flapping hinge. And lead lag is only necessary on rotors that have offset flapping hinges. Underslung teetering rotors, like on the Bell 206 and the Robinson R44, flap about a point that's close to the rotor's center of rotation. Because of this, they don't need the lead lag. These are stiff and plain rotors, and we're not talking about those types of rotors in today's video. Lead lag is motion about an offset hinge that's in the rotor's plane of rotation. On casual observation, it may be easy to mistake lead lag for rotor rotation. Rotation applies to all of the blades turning about the hub's center of rotation, whereas lead lag is the motion of individual blades where they momentarily speed up or lead the rotation and slow down or lag the rotation. For this particular rotor system, all three degrees of freedom, including lead lag, are hinged at the same point. There are other types of rotor systems where each degree of freedom has a separate hinge location. It's this offset hinge that creates the need for lead lag motion. And as explained in a previous video, this offset flapping motion is needed to control the helicopter. But when it does this, the blade's center of gravity moves radially towards and away from the center of rotation. When flapping is neutral, the blade is perpendicular to the mast and the center of gravity is at its farthest point from the center of rotation. And when the blade is at its maximum or minimum flapping, the center of gravity is at its closest point to the center of rotation. This shift in the center of gravity changes the blade's moment of inertia. In any rotating system, changes in mass distribution cause changes in rotational forces. These forces are created because the moment of inertia changes when the center of gravity moves relative to the center of rotation. There's a name for the force that results from the change in moment of inertia. It's called the Coriolis force, and it's named after the French mathematician who first wrote the equation for this force when he was studying water wheels. So if your flight instructor asks you why rotor blades have a lead lag hinge, you could say it's because of Coriolis force, or you could say it's because of the conservation of angular momentum. They both refer to the same thing, and they're both correct answers. By the laws of physics, specifically the rotational equivalent of Newton's second law, angular momentum must be conserved. The system's angular momentum before and after this center of gravity shift must remain the same. You've probably seen the conservation of angular momentum in action. Think of a spinning ice skater. When she pulls her arms in, she spins faster. The skater isn't exerting any more energy, she's simply reducing her moment of inertia, which causes her rotation speed to increase. The same concept applies to helicopter rotor blades. When they flap away from neutral, their moment of inertia decreases, so their rotation speed must increase. And when they flap towards neutral, their speed must decrease again. Because flapping varies cyclically, this variation in rotation speed also varies cyclically. When it comes to these small periodic changes in angular speed, you might think there's no issue. The whole rotor is rotating, so maybe these changes in rotation speed could be absorbed in the drive system with slight fluctuations in rotor RPM. But each blade leads and lags independent of the other blades. When one blade needs to increase its angular speed, another blade needs to reduce its angular velocity. Also, this change in rotation speed occurs over half of a rotor revolution. The mass of the rotating gears and drive shafts wouldn't be able to absorb a sudden, almost instantaneous change in rotation speed. So instead, lead lag hinges are added to the design to absorb these small changes in angular velocity. These hinges allow the blades to cyclically lead ahead of and lag behind main rotor rotation. In hovering flight, this periodic lead lag motion only depends on the flapping motion of the blade. But in forward flight, the blades will see an additional excitation force due to cyclic variations in drag on the advancing and retreating blades. In Aerodynamics of the Helicopter, Gessow and Meyers note the cyclic variation in lead lag due to flapping is relatively small, on the order of 1.2 to 2 degrees. However, the mean lag angle due to drag is larger, up to 10 degrees of lag at full power and 1 degree of lead in autorotation. You may have noticed in my animation and from actual looking at real helicopters that there's a mechanical damper for lead lag motion, but not for flapping. This is because the force that causes flapping, that's lift on the blades, is 90 degrees away from centrifugal force. Because of the 90 degree angle between the excitation force and the restoring force, blade flapping is naturally heavily damped. However, in lead lag, the Coriolis force that causes lead lag is in the same plane as centrifugal force. The excitation and restoring force are in the same plane, and this results in a lightly damped system, and this requires the addition of a mechanical damper. With this last video on lead lag, I've now covered all three rotor degrees of freedom: flapping, feathering, and lead lag. I had a viewer request for a video on how the tail rotor works and another on autorotation. If you'd like to see me cover any other topics, please let me know in the comments. And thanks for watching. We'll see you on the next video.